Hey, PC World fans, Adam here with Gordon.
Hey.
And for every year, for the past couple years I can think of, we have done a video comparing Intel versus AMD. So it is the end of 2020. There's been a lot of awesome hardware that has come out this year. But I want to ask this question again. For a first-time PC builder, for a long-time PC builder, whether you're at the low end, whether you're at the high end, excluding large socket, excluding APUs, what is the best platform to buy into right now, Gordon? And what are the strengths of Intel? And what are the strengths of AMD? What are the weaknesses of Intel? What are the weaknesses of AMD? All of it.
First, I want to give the standard issue disclaimer.
Mm-hmm.
All PCs are personal. That's why we call them personal. There is no wrong decision. It's the right decision for you. What you want to buy, don't listen to the internet, what they're telling you to buy, because they're some fan of something. But let me tell you, right now, if you're looking at performance, because we are looking at performance of a desktop CPU, not workstation, not, you know, ultra budget, it is just, it's AMD all over it. I was just rereading my review of Ryzen 5000. It is destruction derby there with AMD CPUs just crushing Intel everywhere. Things that the Ryzen 3000 had a strength on, but maybe had a little soft spot. Ryzen 5000 has no soft spots. If you care about performance, it's like there's nothing Ryzen 5000 can't do. It can do gaming. It can do single-threaded performance, like, say, browsing, Photoshop, all those kinds of things, Office. It's just awesome. And, of course, if you want to do, you know, multi-core performance where you're going to be doing modeling or you just need all those cores, Ryzen, of course, has always been there, and Ryzen 5000 doesn't give that up. But the Ryzen 5000 really lifted up the left side, that single-threaded, lightly-threaded performance of Ryzen that's sort of been its weakness ever since it's been here. That's all gone. And Intel, it feels like going back again for the last few years, it feels like Intel's been standing still since for 3 years now. It really does feel that way, where we've gone maybe to 8 and 10 cores, but AMD goes all the way to 16 and Intel stops at 10. And for performance in gaming, you would really, really, really have to look hard for the things that Intel exceeds in. And there are some things that it does better at. There's always those things in the PC. Some things just simply run better on Intel. Mm-hmm. It's been the dominant microarchitecture on the PC for years and years and years. Everybody writes software for it. They own compilers. They have quick sync. There's all these kind of things that really, yeah, there might be some things that Intel's faster in. But let me tell you, 90% of everything else is going to be AMD.
Now, so you're talking about performance, and you're saying AMD across the board. What about price? What if somebody's a little bit more, you know, price conscious, and they're kind of looking for the best performance per dollar?
So if you're looking for best performance per dollar, it very much depends on what performance means, because if you actually are looking at best performance per dollar for a 16-core desktop chip, you're only going to get that from AMD. It's actually a better deal if you buy a 16-core AMD chip than a 10-core Intel chip. But as you get down to where most regular people buy, you know, 8 cores, 6 cores, there it actually gets a lot closer. And one of the things AMD no longer has down at, like, say, Ryzen 5 5600X, it doesn't have that advantage of, hey, we just got to give you more cores. So not quite there. And frankly, if you're buying a 6-core machine these days, it's mid-range, which is kind of crazy. You probably don't need it to do 3D modeling, because if you did, you would buy a 16-core. So I would say they're on a lot closer ground than ever before. Ryzen 5 3600 has traditionally given you awesome performance, but due to world events, it's actually gone up in prices. The Ryzen 5 3600 actually costs more than the Intel chip in a lot of places. So it's a little off kilter. So I think if you're on that sort of, like, well, more realistic, it can be neutral as far as the actual value goes per core. If you're looking at 16 cores, it's all AMD, but most people are not buying, you know, $800 CPUs.
Okay. What about, and I'm not a huge fan of this word necessarily, but I can't think of a better one. What about future proofing? Is there one platform that's a little better at future proofing? Because we're kind of at the end of AM4, right? That's always been the AMD strength to say, hey, you've got support for different chips coming down the line. But do you think it's worth it still to on AMD on that?
Yes. Thank you for that question from the Intel section of Reddit. It is actually a strange spot we may be in because AM4 will indeed be the end of the line for Ryzen. You never say never, because this is AMD here. They love saying never say never and then saying, well, actually, we didn't really mean never. I do think with DDR5, that's expected. Maybe even PCIe 5, all kinds of coolness. You may see AMD finally break with AM4. It's not necessarily a bad thing, but it does mean that Ryzen 5000, Zen 3, and AM4 motherboards, this will be the end of the line. Time to get out, get on to the next train. On Intel, typically, as we know, Intel likes to leave you, make you get off at every stop and buy a new ticket. They actually may not do it this time, because if you do buy, say, Intel 10th gen LGA 1200 board, all indications are that the next generation Intel CPU, my brain is working now, it's the end of the day, Rocket Lake, which will be a newer microarchitecture built on its older 14 nanometer process, it may actually be able to take the next generation Intel CPU. Of course, never say never, because it is Intel. They do, again, like to make you get off at every stop and buy a new CPU, a new motherboard, because that's kind of the only way to avoid problems. But if you're looking at sort of that future proofing thing, if you're coming from a Core i5 on an LGA 1200, you may actually get the next generation CPU than you will from an AM4 CPU and system. So that's a little weird. Of course, we don't know if Intel's next generation CPU will be all that. In fact, will it actually beat Ryzen 5000? And that's something you have to weigh. But if you just like the idea of having one more stop before you got to get off, AM4 is the last stop, it looks like, and LGA 1200 may have one more stop.
Okay. And the last question for me to consider, security. There's a lot of people who say that, you know, Intel has got lots of holes, and that's a reason to go AMD. What do you think right now at this point?
Yeah, I mean, that's tough. I think those considerations on security weaknesses, I'm not a security expert by any stretch of the means. I do think with every new iteration of CPU, Intel tends to roll in newer mitigations to reduce those security issues. AMD has generally been far more secure, but again, I'm not a security expert. Is it because you go where the money is? If Intel is 70% of the market, you're going to go attack 70% of things. You know, it's like going fishing. It's just more fish in that ocean than there is of AMD. I don't know. But generally, if you are really concerned about security, then I do think, yeah, AMD is probably a better idea. But you do have to consider Intel is always constantly rolling in new mitigations. But people looking for exploits are, again, they like to go fishing where all the fish are. And in this ocean, it is mostly Intel fish. There's just way, way more Intel fish in the ocean. So that could be a big factor. It doesn't matter which is more secure. It's what's being attacked. So AMD is probably better. But actually, Adam, I do want to point out one more thing.
Oh, please, please.
So the one thing I think you really got to consider if you're watching this video is you do have to think about availability, right?
Oh, true.
Right? It's weird because we are in the strangest, bizarre world for the last 2 years, 3 years we've done this video. Intel's been a hard spot. You couldn't get their chips anywhere.
Yeah.
Nowhere, right? Just none at all. It's now flipped again because now Ryzen 5000, again, I told you every single reason, 90% of you are going to want Ryzen. It's just, if you're into performance, it's better. It gives you PCIe 4, all that goodness. Good luck finding one.
Oh.
And I swear to God, it's like it doesn't even exist. It's like I reviewed that CPU. Everybody reviewed it. There's videos of it. And then you know what Intel did? They did that Thanos snap. It's gone. It doesn't exist. Because if you go out there, you're not comparing your Core i5, you know, 10600K or 10850K against a Ryzen, 7, 5000 part. You're comparing it against Ryzen 3000 chips because it's like Ryzen 5000 doesn't even exist. I don't think anybody's ever seen one in weeks, it feels like. And and it really does feel like it's gone, like it's vanished. And the weirdest thing is I was just on a story and I could find, Core i5, no problems. Core i9, 10850K, $430. 10 core, sure. May not compete with that Ryzen chip that basically has again been Thanos snapped and just not feeling so well, Mr. Stark. It's gone. Maybe you're just happy to have something, and that is something Intel gives you. You can actually buy their stuff at not exorbitant prices. You can get the motherboards. It's there. And even though AMD has an advantage in some games, generally closer, having it versus not having it is better than nothing, right?
So it's true.
I don't know. You feel like you're going to be Ant-Man going up and looking at a wall and seeing Ryzen 9 5900X on that wall in the Avengers movie. Sorry if there's spoilers. If you haven't seen
spoilers,
it yet, come on.
Spoilers, jeez. But, hopefully, cross your fingers, all that'll change and we won't have to worry about availability. Who knows what 2021 is going to bring. Obviously, yes. We have new CPUs coming out next year as well. We will redo this video at that time. But thank you for going over the landscape for me right now at the end of 2020, Gordon. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, I don't feel so well, Mr. Stark. That's the line.
All right, we'll talk to everyone. Bye.